Welcome back to Free Engineering Tutorial on Operating System. So in previous video, we had discussed about round robin scheduling. Now in this video, we will discuss about thread scheduling. Okay, so the thing is, what we had studied till now are the types of kernel threads which are handled or scheduled by operating system. But there are other threads also which are scheduled by threading libraries. Okay, so like we can say that the threads which belong to the same process are handled by thread libraries. These are not handled by operating system. So there are two type of contention scopes. What is contention scope is that to make a decision whether this thread is like there are through two threads. So whether this thread should execute or this one is executed. So this is decided by contention scope. Okay, so on system implementing the many to one and many to many. So as I had discussed in previous videos, there are types like these are user threads and this is kernel thread. So many user threads are executing one kernel thread. So this is many to one model. And if we will discuss about many to many, so this is a type of 3:2 means m is to n model or many to many model. So for the lightweight process, a scheme known as process contention scope is implemented to decide whether which process thread is to be executed. Okay, so as we know, the competition is among the threads which belong to the same process. Okay, so for these type of threads, we use system contention scope. Okay, so this is all about thread scheduling, and there are functions which are deployed or which are being used for pthread scheduling. So the main threads attributes are pthread attribute set scope, and the one with for getting is called get scope. There is also one implementation by inter-process communication means messaging type for setting and getting. Okay, for this getting and setting the contention scope policy. So the one we had discussed in previous slide, the contention scopes. So which contention scope is to be deployed? It is discussed by pthread IPC. Okay. So now we will discuss about multiprocessor scheduling. So under multiprocessor scheduling, there are two types of multiprocessors. One is asymmetric and one is symmetric. So in asymmetric, there is master slave type of processing designing. Or okay, so means one is master server and the other, or master processor we can say that, and it will give the commands to other processor or other servers to execute different type of commands. Like you can say that the other processors execute only user code. Okay, so one who is giving the commands or ordering, and one who will fulfill the request, or one who will fulfill the order. Okay, so these are slave servers and this is master server. So this is master and this is slave. Now in what we can say that symmetric multiprocessor. So in symmetric multiprocessor, all processors are independent. Okay, so they do have their own private queue. Like you can see that they do have their own private queue of its ready processes. Okay, so like there are two processors. So they both work independently and they have their own queue which contains processes to execute. Like there are three processes for this processor and two processes for this processor. So this is symmetric type of multiprocessing scheduling. So now we will discuss about processor affinity. So as we can see in previous slide, we had discussed about multiprocessor scheme. So if there are multiple processors and there are different type of processes, let's say if one process, 1 minute. So this is one processor and this is another processor and this is its queue and this is this one's queue. Okay, so this is one and this is two. Okay, now let's say if a process is already being executed by this. Okay, so this processor also has its own cache memory also. Okay, so this is C1 and this is C2. Okay, so now after completion of execution of this process, now let's say if this process also requests for the what we can say execution. Okay, and it is assigned this processor 2. Now this cache of for this process is being wasted because it has to migrate from here to here. So under this migration, it will take a lot of time. Okay, or we have to rebuild the cache in the second processor. So there is affinity in the processors. What affinity? Affinity means it will resist the same process which is being executed in this processor from being executed in another processor. What I meant by not executing in another processor is that if one process, let's say this P1, is once executed in this processor 1, again if it requests for the execution time for or you can say that if it requests for the resources of the CPU, it will be given or allocated in this processor only. It will not be given to the another processor because this processor already have cache for this process. So this is known as processor affinity. So there are two types of processor affinity. One is soft affinity and one is hard affinity. So we need not to have to go in detail for these type of affinities. So just we have to know about there are two types of affinities, soft affinity and hard affinity. So as there are different type of processors and like asymmetric processor and symmetric processor, so we also need load balancing among these. Okay, so different processors have the same or equivalent loads. It is governed by load balancing concept. So the definition itself completes the explanation is that it attempts to keep the workload evenly distributed across all processes in the SMP system. Okay, so what is it is saying is that this is seesaw, no? So there should be no type like it should be not like this or it should not be like this. It should always be like this balancing. Okay, so if the seesaw is balanced, then everyone will enjoy. So this is a type of load balancing. The load on both sides are equally balanced. It should not be asymmetric. Okay, so this is the process which is done by load balancing. So there are two types of load balancing migration. One is push migration, the other one is pull migration. Again, we don't need have to go in detail about these type of migrations. And there are some multi-core processor. So the modern processors which are coming in our computers are known as multi-core processors. In multi-core processors, each processor have their own cores and they do have their own chips also. Okay, so like in traditional processors, if there are different multi-processors, you can say that, and these are in the single core. Okay, so they do have their own single chip. Every processor have to wait for any other process to complete its memory functions, okay, or data accessing functions to become to wait for the chip to be free and execute or request fulfill the request of their process. Okay, so what I'm saying is that if there is one process which is accessing data from this chip, okay, so now this P2 have to wait for the chip to be free, and then when chip will be free, it will fulfill the request of this P2. Okay, so this is known as memory stalling. Okay, but it is not so in this multi-core processor. So in multi-core processor, you can see that there are P1, P2, P3. Okay, so this is P1, P2, P3. Okay, so they do have their own chips, okay, private chips, and if they want memory from the means you can say that chips, so they will use their own private chips and will access the data. So P2 need not to have to wait for any other process to fulfill the request. Okay, so by this we can save our time. So you can see that this chip part is fragmented and are given to the processors individually. So this is known as multi-core processor. So when a processor accesses memory, it spends a significant amount of time waiting for data to become available. Just what I had explained in this diagram. So this is known as memory stalling. So it will not happen in multi-core processor. So now we will talk about virtualization and scheduling. So virtualization means the things which are not there in reality or which are not present in reality are the operating system is being virtually, means it will create a virtual environment where it can say that yes, it has the means memory or address space where it can execute the commands. But system with virtualization over a single CPU frequently acts like a multiprocessor system. Okay, so like you can say that in VMware, it executes different type of operating system in one platform. Okay, so it will create a virtual you can say that virtual presence, like there are different operating systems which are executing in same platform, and it looks like it works like multiprocessor. Okay, so this is the advantage of virtualization. We will discuss virtualization in detail in fourth module. Till then we will limit our discussion to this, and it presents one or more virtual CPUs to each of the VM running on the system and then schedules the use. So it will schedules, so means if we have different type of virtualization schemes, we need to schedule them also. So this is done by virtualization and scheduling types. And now in next video, we will discuss about synchronization. Till then, thank you.